Hello friends, welcome back. So today let us talk about albumin, globulin and A to G ratio. So let's start with the introduction of albumin. Albumin is the smallest and the most abundant of plasma proteins. Its net charge is negative at physiological pH of 7.4. It is soluble in water. It is synthesized in the liver. It is a single polypeptide chain having three domains. Its plasma half-life is lying between 15 to 19 days. The functions of albumin include maintenance of colloidal osmotic pressure, the transport function where it transports various ions, molecules, hormones, and drugs. It has nutritive function due to the presence of all the essential amino acids in the right proportion. It also has buffering function due to the presence of histidine residues, and it is reported to have antioxidant functions. The clinical significance of estimation of serum albumin is that elevated serum albumin levels are seen in dehydration, whereas decreased serum albumin levels are found in a wide variety of conditions such as kidney disease, liver disease, malabsorption, malnutrition, severe burns, infections, and hemodilutions. The method of estimation for serum albumin are bromocresol purple. However, the reference method or the gold standard method is the immunochemical method and the mass spectrophotometric method, which are very specific. The other methods include electrophoresis and isoelectric focusing. The current method that is being discussed in this case is the BCG method or the bromocresol method, which is an endpoint method and a colorimetric method. The bromocresol green is actually a dye which combines with albumin in a pH of 4 to 4.2 to form an albumin BCG complex, which is yellowish green in color. The intensity of yellowish green color is proportional to the concentration of albumin at 620 nanometers. The sample collection is done by phlebotomy, so both types of samples can be collected here, either plasma or serum. However, the most common type of sample is the serum sample because many other blood parameters can be tested with the help of serum of the same sample. The procedure includes labeling of three test tubes with blank, standard and test. Once the test tubes are labeled, we can add 100 microliters of distilled water in the tube labeled blank, 100 microliters of standard having known concentration in the tube labeled standard, and 100 microliters of patient sample in the tube labeled test. The concentration of albumin in this sample is unknown. Then after that, we can take 5 ml of BCG solution and add to each tube, mix the contents and take reading at 620 nanometers. The readings are mentioned here. The precautions to be followed while carrying out the estimation of serum albumin is that the BCG method reading should be taken immediately to avoid reaction of BCG with other fractions of proteins. Now, at the end of the reaction, this is how the end product will look. The distilled tube having distilled water blank will be colorless, whereas the tube having reagent blank will have the color of BCG reagent, which is yellowish, and the tubes having albumin will show some green shades of green color. This is the colorimeter where we have set the appropriate wavelength, and now we are setting it to zero with distilled water blank. Whenever the reagents are colored, we first have to set zero with distilled water. After that, we put the reagent blank. So we are using two blanks here. One is a distilled water blank and one is the reagent blank. The readings of reagent blank will be used in calculation. Then we take the reading of absorbance of standard and then the absorbance of test. The absorbance is displayed in the monitor. We will use the same readings for calculation. The reference range of albumin is between 3.5 to 5.5 grams per deciliter. Based on this reference range, we shall be able to tell whether the sample done here has normal concentration of albumin or not. Now, the calculation for serum albumin follows this formula, where the concentration of serum albumin is 4 grams per deciliter. The absorbance of test minus blank and divided by absorbance of standard minus blank on calculation gives 2 grams per deciliter. So based on the result of the test carried out, you can say that the sample has less amount of albumin. This condition is termed as hypoalbuminemia, and let us see the causes of hypoalbuminemia. So it follows in three categories. The first category is decreased production of albumin, which may be due to protein malnutrition or defective synthesis of albumin. The second category is due to increased loss of albumin, which may be due to protein losing enteropathy, nephrotic syndromes, or excessive burns. The third category, however, includes redistribution of fluid, which may be seen in inflammation or vasculature or hemodilution. Now let us see the effects or the complications of hypoalbuminemia. First and the most common effect of hypoalbuminemia is edema. Whenever there is decreased albumin, you see decrease in osmotic pressure, which is causing edema. So whenever there is decreased albumin, there is decrease in plasma colloidal osmotic pressure, which decreases the force of drawing water into the capillary from interstitium. And this leads to increased formation of interstitial fluid or increased accumulation of fluid in the interstitial spaces. This in turn leads to edema in the extremities. As you can see, this is a case of pitting edema, where on applying pressure to the feet and then removing the pressure, the pit, the depression still remains, and it takes some time to come back to its original place. The second complication is Kernig teres, which may be caused in case of hypoalbuminemia. This is generally seen in preterm babies, where unconjugated bilirubin cannot bind to albumin, and therefore free bilirubin crosses the blood-brain barrier and starts depositing in the brain, which may cause Kernig teres in preterm infants. The third effect of hypoalbuminemia is hypocalcemia. Hypocalcemia is actually, as you know, that whenever we estimate calcium, it is the total calcium we estimate, that is the bound form and the ionized form. So the bound form of calcium is always with albumin. So when we are estimating calcium, the total calcium, since albumin is less, less amount of calcium will be detected. So that even if the person has normal calcium, it will actually appear less than its true value. This is called hypocalcemia due to hypoalbuminemia. So whenever a person's patient's serum levels of total calcium is reduced, it is important to check the albumin levels also. And here the formula is given for correcting the values of calcium after checking albumin levels, and it is known as corrected calcium, where the obtained value of calcium is added to this factor here, 0.84 minus serum albumin. And this is how you can correct the value of albumin and get the true value. That is why it is known as corrected calcium. And this is seen, this formula is used when the patient has hypocalcemia due to hypoalbuminemia. That is, actually the calcium values are normal, but due to less albumin in circulation, it appears to be less. It's a false low value. Causes of hyperalbuminemia. The only clinical condition that causes an elevation in serum albumin is acute dehydration, and it is of no clinical significance. Now there is another third condition, which is analbuminemia, which is rare autosomal recessive disorder. It is characterized by the absence of sudden reduction of circulating albumin. It is life-threatening in infants, but it is sustainable in adulthood. Affected individuals have few clinical symptoms like mild edema, hypotension, and fatigue. The serum globulins are of three types, that is alpha, beta, and gamma. Alpha is the smallest, whereas gamma is the largest. Now let us see the subfractions. The alpha globulins have alpha 1 and alpha 2 types, whereas the beta globulin also has beta 1 and beta 2 types, and the gamma globulins. So there are in all 5 types of globulins seen in the serum or plasma. The functions of globulin make up to 38% of the proteins. They transport ions, hormones, and lipids. They play an important role in immune functions. Any increase or decrease in the globulin fraction is seen in by serum electrophoresis. So all the different types of globulin fractions are visible in serum electrophoresis method. The A to G ratio and globulin. The globulin reference range lies between 2 to 3.5 grams per deciliter, whereas the A to G ratio lies between 1.5 to 2.5. Now the total protein, which was calculated in the previous link, you can see it is albumin plus globulin, which makes the total protein. So we already have the value of total protein and albumin. From this we can calculate globulin, and the obtained value in this case is 2.1 grams per deciliter. After calculation of globulin, we can find out the A to G ratio. Here the A to G ratio is 1, which is below the reference range. Now let us see the interpretation of the result. First, the clinical significance of A to G ratio. The A to G ratio is decreased or reversed in case of true reduction or false reduction. Now, true reduction of albumin occurs in liver disease, renal disease, and the A to G ratio is totally decreased due to decrease in albumin concentration. False reduction is due to hemoconcentration, where the A to G ratio remains the same, but there is no loss of protein, but only loss of water. Whereas the reversal of A to G ratio is seen in chronic liver dysfunction, where liver is not able to produce albumin sufficiently and the globulins, the gamma globulins, are produced in large quantities. A low A to G ratio may therefore reflect overproduction of globulins, underproduction of albumin, or selective loss of albumin. A high A to G ratio suggests, however, underproduction of immunoglobulins as seen in some of the genetic deficiencies and in some leukemias. Now, these are some of the questions which you have to address, and I'm hopeful that you will be able to answer all of them without much difficulty. So please like, subscribe, and share my channel. Click to the bell icon. Have a good day. Thank you.